We're gonna have the first SIAM student chapter talk of the semester. So we're going to have Francois on this. Here to talk about cosmology and deep learning. So it would mean a lot if you guys could come out, support the SIAM student chapter, hear this talk, you know, meet some people from outside the department, and get some free pizza out of it. Like, I mean, that's why we all come to talks, right? It's the free food. So yeah, that's this Thursday, and continuing on a bi-weekly basis. So that's my spiel. Okay, so my title of my talk is Relaxation and Radon Measures. And it starts with a pretty familiar situation to at least people who are PDEs, calculus of variations type folks. We have some functional, like an integral functional, which is something like the integral over omega of f of u x dx for some integrand f. And, you know, so the normal game is we want to find a minimizer of this functional, so we pick, you know, a minimizing sequence. That is to say, a sequence of un so that the f of un converges to the infimum of f. And so in the normal sort of game that we play, we have, you know, f of p bounded by a constant times, I probably shouldn't use the letter p, f of c is like c to the p for some power p, and we really, really like the case where that means, you know, f of un bounded implies that we need the integral of un to the p bounded, which implies un is bounded in the space Lp of omega. And when p is strictly greater than 1, Lp is a reflexive space, that is to say, the dual of the dual can be identified with Lp itself. And this is the really nice situation from functional analysis, because reflexive spaces are the ones for which we can take a weakly convergent subsequence. And so this is sort of how we get a minimizer. Like, we'll have a weakly convergent subsequence. So, you know, up to a subsequence, un will be converging weakly to some u in Lp. So, the case that I want to talk about today is what happens when we don't have this nice p growth? What if we just have linear type growth on our integrand? Which is a problem that honestly comes up from time to time, like in the theory of, like, sort of elastically, perfectly elastic plates. You're going to see stuff like this in a lot of imaging models. We really just expect this thing to be linear. And I think it's something that's interesting also in its own right. You know, what goes wrong in this case? So This may or may not be a familiar story to you guys, but, so, in general, right, yeah.
Just primarily on the law, so you don't have a coercivity, do you need a reimbursement?
I'm normally thinking of something like this.
But how can I have, the first responding class is out here? You might get some convexity.
Yeah, I'm always thinking of F as convex. Has it been this long since I've done this?
Then you can say that I'm doing.
You think I'm minimizing sequence? Let's say we have coercivity too. So, ultimately, the kind of problem that I'm talking about is, I think I'm being vague here. It's like if we already know that the function is converging. Or we already know that it's LP bounded somehow. So if we have a sequence so that we have this kind of a bound, then it's not necessarily going to be the case that, the problem from functional analysis is the space of L1 integrable functions is not reflexive, and it's not even, but, so the other case that's nice is it is the dual in the separable space. So this is functional analysis stuff. I mean, if that's crazy, it's just like we can't do the nice things that we normally like to do. But if we look at sort of the continuous function with compact support in omega, and we look at the dual of that space, this is going to wind up being the set of signed Radon measures on omega, where continuous functions are separable, and in fact we can sort of identify, like, L1 of omega can embed continuously into the set of measures, right, when we think of the function, you know, sort of mu sub u of e for Radon set e, defined as the integral over e of u of x dx. So somehow u, as looking at u as like a density of the Lebesgue measure, so u sort of times Lebesgue measure in Rn is an element of the finite Radon measures. So we have this nice sort of picture. I mean, if we sort of expand our space by the set of all Radon measures, then we can get at least some kind of compactness out of a bounded sequence. So basically, there exists up to a subsequence un times the Lebesgue measure. combat support. Continuous with combat support. So one thing to say about this kind of convergence is it's worse. It's like worse than even weak convergence in a certain sense. Like, it's really awful and it's annoying to deal with. Because, for instance, you know, if UN goes weekly to you in L2, let's say, then at least we know that, for instance, the integral over every radon for E radon, E Borel, we can say the integral of U over set converges to the integrals of the UN. So we don't even have this property, which is like, come on, guys. Like, in general, the way that I try and, like, keep it straight is if mu n and mu are all non-negative, then we can sort of characterize it nicely. We can say mu n goes weakly to mu. This is the same as mu of an open set is less than or equal to the limit of mu n and mu for open sets. So we have this like lower semi-continuity on open sets. We have upper semi-continuity on compact sets. To sort of convince you why this might be true, it's sort of like, okay, you've got, you know, your set here. And you know, if we were doing this, we would test along characteristic test functions. Here, our test functions can't be characteristic functions, so they either have to, like, overshoot by a little bit in order to stay continuous, in which case, you know, you get a little bit more, or they have to undershoot a little bit, but you can't exactly get it. So this is saying, okay, if you want the whole open set, well, I mean, you might get a little bit more. Or if you want the compact set, you might, like, miss something near the boundary.
So yeah. Just to make sure I have this right, so a witness to this failure of convergence might be, like, the Dirac mass, like, moving along some non-closed Borel set and then, like, reaching the boundary.
But there's more. Yeah, Dirac masses are, like, a nice way to see, because they're everyone's favorite singular measure, right? But somehow what I think is that's like a normal kind of thing that can happen, right? In weak convergence, things can run away to infinity and stuff. Like, they can, the real problem is like the boundary, like, that things can do one more thing that they couldn't do in the LP case, which is they can concentrate on singular sets. So that's like this picture, right? Normally this wouldn't be a problem. But it could, the mass could all concentrate and become sort of like a Hausdorff measure of the boundary here. So in general, in order to say, and this is true for like vector measures, that mu n of E converges to mu of E, we need the total variation of the boundary of E to be zero. So this is like a sufficient condition that you normally need to verify. So this is like, if you're reading any like blow-up proof type arguments, they always are making sure we have this, because they don't want to deal with this problem. Because in general, we only have this weak star convergence. So this is just a diatribe on weak star convergence. And like, I mean, you all know, anyone who's taken like measure theory at all knows the perfect example of when we have weak star, but not, like, we have L1 control and not LP control for any P greater than 1, right? It's this UN is equal to N times the characteristic function of minus 1 over 2N, 1 over 2N, right? This is, we're concentrating mass here. A singular set. So we've got this horizontal thing with area like mass 1. It's exactly controlled in L1 and not in any LP. And obviously, the integral of the UNs on the singleton zero is zero, but we wind up with mass on that set. So this is like one of the main new problems that can happen. But the interesting thing is, let's not think of this as a problem, right? Let's think of this as a feature and not a bug, and something that measures are able, like, you know, this is like, okay, we actually have more diverse behavior that we can describe if we look at the space of measures and not at the space who would deal with a function? No, measures. Measures are where it's at. Okay, so this is all well and good. We've been doing everything with like functions, like, you know, at the level of functions, but obviously, you know, functions are only so interesting, like just, you know, measurable functions. Really, where this, like, people are more and more interested in like Sobolev space, like integral functionals, more of the type integral of f of grad u, rather than integral of f of u, right? This is normally more the integral functional that at least the PDEs or calculus of variations person might study. And in this case, the natural space to consider is not L1 of omega, but W11 of omega. This is the Sobolev space of functions who are L1, who have a distributional gradient that's also an L1. And here we have the same problem that emerges, right? We have bounded sequence in L1, or in W11, well, by the sort of like Sobolev type inequalities, if our gradient is bounded in L1, then our actual function is bounded in a space of higher regularity. So UN will still like have an honest-to-goodness limit U, like a strong limit U, but U, like grad UN, is going to suffer from the same problems. It might just convert Winkley star to some now vector-valued measure. And if you're not comfortable with a vector-valued measure, it's a measure, except it spits out a vector. And let's just leave it at that for this. Like, don't worry too much about it. So we might have this just go into something that we'll call DU. It'll be a measure. It still satisfies the sort of nice distributional derivative. It's just the distributional derivative is just a measure. That is to say, integral of U against some test function is going to equal minus the integral of the test function against sort of the ith component of this. You can think of the vector value function as just n sine Redon measures like staple together, if you want. So this is like, this is just, you know, what you would think it would be. D this measure. And this is D max. Sorry, I should be explicit about what measures I'm integrating over. So these are functions whose derivatives aren't functions but measures. And this is, so U and L1 such that their derivatives are just measures. This has a special name. These are the functions of bounded variation. And in general, in a sequence bounding W11, all we know is that it has a weak limit, like weak star limit, that's a BV function. That's all we got. And so BV functions are actually really nice. Like, or they have some really cool properties. Like, if a set E has a nice enough, which I go any further into that. Nice enough boundary. Then the characteristics function of E is going to be a DV function. And so, you know, this will be a function that's 1 in this set, 0 everywhere else. And its derivative is actually going to be sort of the characteristic set, characteristic function of like, or that's not right, the normal vector to the boundary times the Hausdorff measure restricted to the boundary. So somehow this actually gives us a really nice perspective on geometry. Characteristic sets, if they're viewed as BV functions, their derivative is going to be like the normal vector to the boundary and then the Hausdorff measure. So in particular, if we look at the total variation of this, this will give us like the perimeter of the set E. And in fact, this is a whole direction you can go with this. They're called the sets of finite perimeter, and this gives us a really nice general concept of perimeter of a set of the Hausdorff measure. But I won't get into that. This is just to say, the space BV is really ubiquitous in geometric measure theory, and it's not just like in one hand it's a problem, but on another hand it's a cool place to be in. But let's remember what we started talking about. And so, in the case where we have LP, where everything is happening in LP, P and 1, infinity, we have this really nice result that says necessary and sufficient conditions for this to be lower semi-continuous with respect to weak convergence. Like, because this is the final step in the calculus of variations argument. You have Urn going weakly to U, and then we want to say that our limit is going to be no greater than integral of f of grad Un. So this happens if and only if f is convex. This is the nice result of calculus of variations, classical, you know, check your Fonseca-Leone LP spaces for the proof. So we know that if Un is going weakly star to U, like so, now in P equals 1, if Un goes weakly star to U, and U is an L1, like U is in W11, then we're going to have this nice lower semi-continuity if f is convex. But, I mean, what is the right... It's not even clear, like, how to define this if... Right, because this is saying evaluate f at grad u of x at every point. It's not really clear what the right definition of this is for BV functions if we want a similar kind of lower semi-continuity. Like, right, this is just some functional on W11. We like to extend f of u, f to bv. In a way so that the lower semi-continuity is still there. So there's a really easy way to do this. For U and BV, let F of U be defined to be the infimum over the limit of F of UN over all sequences UN going with restarting. Okay, this is unsatisfying, right? But this is, so this, if you see this, this is called the relaxation. Basically, we're just saying there is some, like, we just look at the greatest thing that's gonna be lower semi-continuous and below F, basically. And this is the thing that does it. Well, obviously, this isn't really interesting. What we're really interested in is, like, can we write it as an integral functional in some sort of way? And here, I'm only thinking about F with linear growth. Because otherwise, this thing is not well defined. Yeah, you're right. It's, to make it well defined, we need linear growth. But we do need coercivity to actually do the calculus of variations. Okay. What do I have time to do? When are these normally over?
Seven.
Okay.
For
me, omega is normally bounded. Yeah, omega's bounded. But it won't actually matter, I think, for what I'm doing. Why are you asking? Just curiosity?
Yeah, and the condition is different if it's not bounded. Or?
Yeah. Okay, bounded. Yeah, so we can't have this. So I don't know. I think it's nice to look at our nice trivial example of functions going weakly star and not strongly. Look at what'll happen when we look at an F which is, you know, convex but not linear. So my favorite example of a function which is convex but not linear but has still linear growth is something like this. So 1 plus norm of c squared. So like a function square root of 1 plus c squared. This is a equals 1 at t equals 0. And it sort of asymptotically approaches the linear functions. So this is like exactly the kind of function. It's nice and convex, but it's definitely non-linear. And let's see what happens if we look at our UNs so that there are these guys. I don't know. They're the functions that are 0 over here, 1 over here, and they jump to 1 in a space of n. So the un prime are precisely these functions that we talked about. Then the UN prime, we're going to go weakly star to the Dirac mass. Happens to integral from, you know, negative 1 to 1 of f of grad un, in this case f of un prime of x dx as n goes to infinity. So outside of this interval, so in this region, which has size 1 minus n, un prime is equal to 0. So we'll just get 1. So we get 1 times 1 minus n, plus, then we get the region of size, region of size n, size 1 over n, where the function is equal to the square root of 1 plus n squared. So as we let n go to infinity, this term, which is sort of in the absolutely continuous part of our target measure, goes to 1, whereas this term, so we sort of are letting n go to infinity and n go to infinity. So in the end, we're going to lose this perspective of like, oh, this thing's really nonlinear. We sort of go off to the tail where this thing does wind up looking pretty linear. And we'll just get 1. So, I mean, this is a really toy example, and I don't mean this to prove anything, but I think it does an okay job of highlighting why I'm about to define this function that I'm about to define. Namely, for f from Rn into R convex, define f infinity of C to be the limit as t goes to infinity of f of t C over t. This is called the recession function. Things to note about this. Okay, this limit exists, I can tell you. If you want to see, it's because the function that maps t to f of t, c minus f of 0 over t, is non-decreasing by q max v. Like, this is the key sort of like trick to see it. So this limit, honest to goodness, does exist. F infinity is going to inherit convexity from f. That's not, you just sort of do this for every t and let the limit go. One important thing about f infinity is it's positively one homogeneous. That is to say, if I look at f infinity of lambda times c, lambda greater than 0, right, this is the limit as t goes to infinity of f of t times lambda times c over t. So I can sort of put a lambda here and a lambda here and get f infinity of c times lambda. So this is the recession function of f, and it's basically doing what we were doing here. We're going off and saying, all that really matters at these singular points, like these singular points, the input is blowing up, but the size is shrinking. And so all that really matters is what's going on at infinity, and that really only depends on the direction in a certain sense. It's one homogeneous. And one homogeneous functions play really nice with weak convergence. So this is going to be the stone-cold style from the past for people who took Giovanni's, was this in Giovanni's Calculus and Variations class, I think? These were Reshetnyak results. So one of these Reshetnyak, this is like a family of results about how one homogeneous functions play with weak convergence. Let's see, if mu n goes weakly slow to mu, then, and f is one Eugenius and convex. So this is the Radonikodym derivative of mu with respect to its absolute, with respect to its total variation. So these are inner vector valued functions, or vector valued measures. So basically this is saying a measure is like a magnitude and a direction everywhere. If we look at the direction, this is going to be less than or equal to the integral of the limit. So these positively one homogeneous convex functions are exactly the ones that are going to be lower semi-continuous with respect to weak convergence and the weak star convergence of measures. And it takes some work, but you can really show that the representation of the relaxed functional singular part up to its Radonikodym derivative, then we get the integral of the absolute continuous part, so this is nice, plus the integral of the recession function . So we actually can exactly compute what this relaxation is. And it's just saying, in the singular part, we need to look at this sort of recession function, because we're going to see this behavior where everything's blowing up in the singular part, but the supporting set is also shrinking, and we're going to see something precisely when these things are, when this thing has linear growth. Quick, you know, calc one exercise. If f of c is the square root of 1 plus absolute value of c squared, then the recession function of f, right, we saw it sort of looks just like an absolute value off at infinity. So the recession function is just the absolute value. So in the case of this particular f, this term here will vanish because this Radonikodym derivative always has magnitude 1. And so in this case we get integral over omega the square root of 1 plus the absolute continuous part squared plus singular part of u measuring omega. And so what happens, like, there's something interesting happening here, which is that if we look at this integral functional that we looked at, right, we're saying, okay, the f of un's converge to 2, but if we actually plug in the Dirac mass to this on the interval negative 1, 1, did I do something wrong? This should be 2. Right, this is the total interval minus this. This is 2 will get two. And then we just look at the Dirac mass evaluated the whole set, that'll give us one. So we actually did better than lower semi-continuity in this case. We actually got the FVN honest to goodness converged to FVU. Even so, there's something like loss, like right, something's happened here because we had functions that were converging weakly and we plugged them in to a convex, like a non-linear function, and yet we got continuity, and that's not supposed to happen, right? We're not supposed to get convergence. So why did we get it in this case? My best answer to this question is that, like, nonlinear functionals behaving badly occurs due to things like oscillation and mass escape. And in this case, when mass is just concentrating, but we allow ourselves to consider singular sets, we catch the mass that might have like concentrated onto a singular set. So to make this more precise, we have this idea of this function that I was talking about isn't just a cooked up one. We have this notion of area strict convergence. So I have measures mu n, and we say that they'll converge area strictly to mu if they're going weakly star, and we have this functional f of mu n converges to f of mu, where f of mu equals so when in the case when we actually have this nice convergence, we'll say that f of mu n converges to f of mu. Or we say that mu n area strictly converges to mu. And somehow this is like a really nice way to characterize that we have concentration of mass, but no oscillation. In the sense that, so this is another Reshetnyak type theorem that says if mu n goes area strictly to mu, then tedious to write, but basically every single integrand of this form is going to actually converge. Like we're gonna get, like, if we have it for one thing, we have it for everything of this form. So like for a whole class of functions. In a certain sense, this is a really nice way to capture the fact that our measures, you know, be like bunching up in places, so we only have weak convergence. But it's not happening because of like the other, like, you know, normal example of weak convergence where our functions are doing this and they're gonna just wind up converging to zero in the end. So like this is actually the problem that causes convexity, like convex things to only be lower semi-continuous. Right, because if we look at, you know, something that oscillates between these two values of a convex function, and they're weakly converging to their average, you can get something lower than the weak star limit. On the other hand, this is saying there is no oscillation. Like, if we have one non-convex functional, so that we actually get continuity, we get it for all, or one convex nonlinear functional, we actually get it for all of them, as long as we pay attention to this mass that's going away due to concentration. And so this is like the nice thing that I've been doing with my life lately is I said, okay, if I have mu some measure on a big set, let's just say mu is a measure like this, then for every omega compactly contained, so the measure of the boundary of omega equals zero. We take mu and we take like the normal convolutions, this is actually going to area strictly converge to mu. So this is like, in fact, we can find a particular sequence of smooth functions which are going to area strictly converge to mu. That is to say, I mean, it's when we put it a certain way, it's like trivial. If we want to approximate a measure with smooth functions that don't oscillate too much, well, you might as well pick the standard way to approximate things, because you're not going to introduce any oscillation, as long as you make sure things can't escape to the boundary. So that's basically my talk. I think I'm like, any further, it's already very technical, so any further is just going to get more technical. I think I'm going to call it this, but thank you all for your time.
Is there any questions about each one? I just want to double check.
Yeah.
So you're saying that if I can find one function f which is convex and has linear growth, and if it is continuous, say that all convex and linear growth function will be
better than convex. It's like a huge space, actually, that you get. You get like continuous functions. I think you need to work a little bit with what your definition of the recession function is, because it may not be well defined. But I think it's like all functions that have a well defined recession function, basically. Like, you get a huge space of functions that are going to be continuous, as long as your sequence is good enough that one strictly convex function behaves nicely. It's surprising. It's a very surprising result. Yeah. But somehow, it's really just saying, like, if one thing goes, then there can't be any oscillation going on. Like, it would get captured. Yeah, it's like, somehow this is like, yeah, if you don't, because it didn't talk come originally from measures, right? It came when people were talking about great U, like grad U, this would be like grad U and DSU in there. So this is where you're looking at really the graph of a function, and you're looking at like the surface area on this, right? I look at the graph of U of X, and then I'm looking at like the surface area on it, right? Then that's going to be the surface area element, the square root of 1 plus grad U squared. And then in jumps, like if U jumps somewhere, this is just giving us like a nice little cylinder. Yeah, so it's actually, we look at the subgraph, and then we close it. That's what we do. So yeah, you get like sort of the boundary of this cylinder. So that's why it's called area restricted. It came originally from people thinking about these as the gradients of BV functions, but it's actually well-defined for any measure.
So
you're saying
that it's enough to look at the graph of function.
So that's just why it's called area strict convergence. But this is a fact about measures, this thing. It doesn't have to do with functions, yeah.
Any other questions? Alright, that's that. And don't forget to come on Thursday.
Yeah.